There are many tales of underhanded dealings in the technology world, but there are only a few as egregious as what I'm about to tell you. This is the story of how Microsoft made a mockery of government agencies, standards compliance, and more. Strap yourself in, folks, we're going to talk about the POSIX subsystem for Windows. What is the POSIX subsystem? Well, I guess you could call it a predecessor to the modern-day Windows subsystem for Linux. On paper, it was intended as a way to provide compatibility for porting Unix applications to Windows NT, but in practice, well, it really existed to let Microsoft bid on contracts for the US federal government. As I'm going to show, the POSIX subsystem can barely run the Vi editor, let alone do anything more complex. Some time ago, I did a fairly in-depth exploration of the subsystem on Twitter. This was then followed up by a live stream which covered everything in depth. Now, we're once again going to embrace NCommander in real time, where we take that live stream, cut it down with a new voiceover and footage, and then release it as a standalone video. So, where do we begin this intrepid adventure? Well, at the beginning, of course, with installing Windows. For this stream, I went with Windows NT 4, Service Pack 6, and Internet Explorer 4, just so I would have Active Desktop. My original research thread, should you be interested, used NT 3.1, but that's really irritating to work with. Furthermore, pretty much everything is the same between both NT 3.1 and NT 4 as far as the POSIX subsystem goes, so for the dredges of sanity I have left, I might as well use the nicer environment. Anyway, with that backstory aside, let me talk a bit about the purpose of POSIX and specifically the Fips standards. Fips, which stands for Federal Information Processing Standards, are a set of documents published by the US federal government. The easiest way I can describe them is that they designate the requirements a computer must adhere to be considered usable for government work. Probably the most well-known of these is Fips 140, which covers data encryption. For a system to be eligible for use in government, and notably get that very sweet US federal government money, it must meet several of these Fips standards. The relevant one for this discussion is Fips 151, which defines that a computer must support POSIX, which is a standard set of programming interfaces, and is more or less a codification of the Unix C API, which had been in use since the 1980s. Microsoft, in what I can best describe as a blatant abuse of the rules, basically shipped the absolute minimum they were required to. For anyone trying to use this to run Unix applications on Windows NT, well, honestly, I'd say it's better to consider it non-existent. However, just to be perfectly clear, Windows NT is POSIX compliant, and Microsoft does cite the system passes the official NIST test suite. From what I've seen, I've got no reason to doubt this claim. It just so happens that most people expect a bit more than the absolute minimum. Just to drive this point home, let me quote from the official Windows NT Resource Kit book just to highlight how hamstrung POSIX applications actually are. POSIX applications have no direct access to the Win32 subsystem, such as memory map files, networking, graphics, or dynamic data exchange. In fact, POSIX applications are actually sandboxed and essentially run separate from everything else. It should also be noted that the POSIX environment only provides source code compatibility. There's no magic that lets you run pre-existing binaries here like the modern-day subsystem for Linux. Furthermore, in what is becoming a recurring theme, you only get access to approximately 110 C functions, which represent the absolute bare minimum needed to comply with the POSIX 0.1 specification. But well, while I could bore you with more dry technical mumbo jumbo, let's just get right into it. After finishing up the Windows NT 4 installation, we're ready to begin. Out of the box, the system ships with a single POSIX utility known as PAX. It's a file archiver made by the IEEE that can compress and decompress tar and CPIO archives. It's not a particularly useful tool in and of itself, but well, it's all you get. If you want something like, oh, I don't know, a shell, you're almost out of luck. In fact, to do anything resembling useful, you need quite a few other components, none of which were included out of the box. First, you need the Windows NT resource kit. Said kit either had to be purchased in the form of a book, or you could get it directly from Microsoft. As far as I can tell, you kinda had to know that the resource kit would have things like this, and it wasn't commonly seen. By and large, Microsoft resource kits were only meant to be used by system administrators, and I can't say they were commonly available. Assuming you could even obtain the resource kit, then after installation, you can find a folder with a compiled set of POSIX binaries with somewhat familiar names. The resource kit documents that you need to disable a feature called traverse checking, which is part of the security system, but it's only a piece of the puzzle. Some searching turned up an old TechNet article which documents setting up some system environment variables as well as providing a termcat file for BI. After doing this, it's possible to run sh.exe successfully, however, none of the other commands will work as expected. That's because they need to be renamed both to drop the .exe extension and to lowercase, since in a rather cursed bit of ancient voodoo, POSIX applications running under Windows are case sensitive. And yes, this applies to files created through the POSIX environment as well. This leads to some powers that might be considered unnatural, but I digress. Now, at this point, you can use sh and vi, but that's about it. There's only a small handful of commands included, so if you want to do anything past this point, you're going to need both a compiler and a copy of the system development kit. Let's start with the compiler, and well, I just installed Visual C++ 6.0, since it was the cheap and dirty solution to the problem. Unfortunately, it's not enough by itself. To actually build a POSIX mode binary, you still need more add-on bits. I suspect this was done so no one in their right mind would attempt to do what we are doing here now. To get past this point, you need to install the Windows NT Software Development Kit, and this was not a piece of software most people had. By and large, compilers including Visual C++ came with a cut-down version of the SDK, or some, like MingW, provide unofficial re-implementations of Microsoft copyright code. That means that the NT SDK was generally only ever needed in cases where you had to write applications that took advantage of uncommon or rarely used APIs. The best comparison I can make is that it is essentially the unabridged tome of Eldritch lore for Win32 programming. You should never need it, and, well, if you do, I'm sorry. Anyway, like the resource kit, it either had to be ordered directly from Microsoft or was available as a CD in some MSDN subscriptions. That means to even get started with the POSIX environment, you needed two fairly rare and obscure pieces of software and a copy of Visual C++ on top of it. Do I really need to spell out how obscene this is? Assuming you have done all the above correctly, you can now build POSIX mode software, starting with, you guessed it, the rest of the utilities. Microsoft, in an unusual move, shipped tools like Make and More in source code form only, and left only very scant hints on how to build it. Assuming you've arranged all the arcane runes correctly and patched the code to fix a few hard-coded options, you'll end up with a slightly less threadbare environment. This includes both cc.exe and devserver.exe. Which brings me to an important point. There are actually two ways to build POSIX mode applications. The first one is to use cc.exe, which wraps Visual C++ to have a more Unix-like command line interface. However, since POSIX applications can't normally interact with Windows ones directly, there's a fairly ugly kludge involved. Included with cc is devserver, which is a binary that looks for a given file, runs Visual C++ for you, and then returns the result. Getting dev server to work the first time was, to put it bluntly, an exercise in pain. Even when it does work, Clunky doesn't even begin to describe the experience. However, if set up properly, you can build a POSIX mode Hello World binary using CC, as seen here. This, however, falls apart when you try to build more complex projects. In my off-stream research, I tried in vain to run a configure script and concluded that too much basic functionality is just flat out missing. Furthermore, while a copy of BSD Make is included, I couldn't get it to work properly. By and large, what it appears is that you're intended to create a specific build file for the Windows NMake utility and then build from the Win32 environment. This is how all the provided source code is built. However, it wouldn't be an NCommander project if I didn't try to do something with it. However, I was struggling to find anything that could run with such a limited programming interface. Even Rogue, a classic Unix game, and the origin of the term roguelike, was dependent on missing functionality such as terminal handling functions. Out of desperation, I took a copy of the BSD games collection from the late 1980s and then tried to see what I could and couldn't build. For example, it was impossible to build a C version of Adventure since there was no RAND or strand functions provided. I did, however, manage to build Trek, a console-based Star Trek game based around the original series with some effort. So I guess that probably makes me one of the very few people who have actually built something with this other pile of rubbish. The binary is available as a supporter perk, incidentally, if you want to play with it. I spent the remainder of the stream looking at parts of the POSIX subsystem headers and symbol files, and all I can say is that it's impressive on how half-baked it is. I do have to wonder if anyone tried to use it back in the day, given how nearly impossible it would have been to track down all the components needed. At least the later services for Unix were somewhat usable. At this point, I spent several days of my life researching and debugging this excuse of an implementation, and I can't imagine anyone successfully used it in the 1990s. It just existed so Microsoft could claim POSIX compatibility, and was more or less ignored in favor of other solutions such as SIGWIN. Finally, the industry as a whole seems to have learned from this mess. While I can't necessarily say it was the result of the POSIX subsystem, later standards involving interoperability have been considerably more defined, and by and large, the NT implementation of POSIX is more or less kept alive as a warning tale to anyone who dares write a standard. That is, incidentally, how I learned about it originally. I have no doubt that the single Unix specification was written in full knowledge of what would happen if they didn't define everything. Also, since I'll probably never have a chance to mention this again, there's a credit in the POSIX specification referring to a contest in the 1980s involving something called Weirdnecks, with the two winners being Most Serious and Most Demented. I can't help but feel that this video fits very much in that spirit. Anyway, on that note, I suppose that basically wraps up this very brief tour of what might be one of the most half-baked things ever shipped out of Redmond, Washington. One final note before I close though. The POSIX subsystem was available for the RISC-based versions of Windows NT, so perhaps for a later livestream, I could be talked into compiling Trek for MIPS. It seems as good of a cursed computing project as any. Let me know below. As usual, if you've enjoyed this content, please like and subscribe. If you really enjoyed this content, consider supporting the channel with the links in the description. Until next time, this is NCommander, signing out, wishing you all a pleasant day.